I'm Joshua Bardwell, and you're going to learn something today. Today, we're looking at the Aomway Commander goggles. These goggles are $350, which puts them competitive with Fat Shark's budget line, if $350 could be called budget, Fat Shark's budget line Attitude V4s. But they got a lot of features that the Attitude V4s don't. We're going to take a close look at these goggles and help you decide if this is where your $350 is best spent. It would be really easy for me throughout this review to just compare these goggles head-to-head against Fat Shark. Fat Shark is clearly the big gorilla in this space. Many of us have been buying Fat Shark for a long time, even though some of us have been griping about how expensive they are and about how slow the pace of Fat Shark's innovation is. If you look at today's Fat Shark goggles and you compare the feature set to the Fat Shark goggles of 2 or 3 years ago, not a lot has changed. I mean, some things have changed. But think about flight controllers 2 or 3 years ago. Think about quadcopters. So much has changed in such radical ways. And Fat Shark goggles are kind of just keep doing what they do. And they do it really well. But it's really exciting to see other vendors coming along and shaking things up and doing things that you go, well, why hasn't Fat Shark done this? Fat Shark, why haven't you done some of these things? Let's take a closer look at these goggles, and I'll tell you what features I did and didn't like about them. And to be honest with you, there were more things I liked than things I didn't like, but there were a few things I didn't like, and we'll get to those. If we just take a run around the basic controls, we can see we've got the channel and band button here. We've got this switch, which controls the brightness and contrast by moving it left, right, and up and down, and by pressing it, you switch modes. So the modes this goggle supports are 16:9 widescreen, 4:3, and 3D modes, 3D analog and 3D digital input. Oh, by the way, yeah, it's got a digital input. Oh, there it is. It's got an HDMI input. So it'll take 720p input from a computer or a Connex Pro site or whatever you have. It'll take it right in there via HDMI. That's not something you find on very many $350 sets of goggles. It'll also do 3D if you're into that, but I don't know many people who are. Over here, we've got the DVR control. You can use it to navigate the DVR menu to start and stop play on the DVR. And here is the head tracker and the fan button. The goggle does not come with a head tracker. You have to buy a separate head tracker module, except if you look at the Banggood listing, I've got a link down in the video description, they say that it's actually the new version of the goggles, V2 or whatever, is coming with a head tracker built in. So yeah, you guys who bought early missed out on a head tracker. Well, what are you going to do? So now they come with a head tracker, and this activates the head tracker if that's what you're into. Another feature I like about these goggles very much is the headband. Now the headband is, you know, goes around the back of your head, right? But it also has this piece that goes over the top of your head. And it's a small thing, but a lot of times when I put the Fat Sharks on, I have to kind of wiggle them and adjust them. And with this headband, once you've got it adjusted to the correct size for your head, it just really slips on and feels a lot more secure and easier to put on. I really like it, and I actually kind of thought about stealing this headband from the Aomways and putting it on my Fat Sharks. So yeah, there you go. The headband stores the battery here in the back. And so the battery would just go on like so. Just like so. And so the battery is going to be centered on your head. And that's kind of nice. It's in the back of your head and it's centered, as opposed to the big old dog bone hanging off the side. Especially if you use the stock Fat Shark batteries, they're freaking huge. And you definitely do feel them sort of rubbing up against the side of your temple here, whereas this is in the back of your head. One downside of this is that you do have to use this extension cable to come around to the power. I've got it installed backwards, but you get the point. Now the extension cable is very clever in that it's set up for 3S, 2S, or 4S even, in theory. I'm not sure I'm a massive fan of this approach. It's not very clean. It's not very neat. But it is nice. I do like the idea of having the battery mounted in the back. It does mean that you could theoretically take a much bigger battery if you wanted to and stick it in the back and it'd like be nicely centered. Or you can use really any size battery you want. Whereas with the Fat Shark goggles, you're kind of locked into a battery that fits in that side pouch there. The goggles have IPD adjustment, pupillary distance adjustment. I am not a big fan of the build quality on this. It doesn't have little clicks like the Fat Shark ones do, so finding the same position again might be tricky. If you want to, I mean, you have to just squint and measure every time. But the other thing is that at least one of this one is really loose and it doesn't really hold position well. This one's got some tension on it, and it would probably stay in position if you left it. This one, I find if it's been banging around in the case, it's constantly moved and I'm constantly having to readjust it. Fortunately, I use the narrowest IPD setting on my goggles, and even then it's oftentimes not quite narrow enough, so it's easy for me to find the exact right position. But for somebody who had a middle IPD, it would be, this I think is just an issue of build quality. It's just a little, it doesn't really lock in there, and they don't have the sort of ratcheting mechanism that the Fat Sharks do. They just have tension and they slide. For the next part of the demonstration, I'm going to get my camera right up here in the lens, and I'm going to press the channel change button and show you what may be the coolest feature these goggles have. A freaking OSD in the goggles, where you can see, I don't know if you can read that, but you can see the battery voltage and the channel that you're on. And if you go changing the brightness, it reads out the brightness and the contrast. But there you go. As you scroll through the channels, you don't have to lift the goggle off and look at your freaking module to see what freaking channel you're on. Fat Shark, why is this so hard for you to accomplish? Put a freaking OSD in your goggle, Fat Shark. Sheesh. Anyway, and the battery voltage. Being able to see the battery voltage. No more, I wonder how full my battery is. I need to go get a special battery pack with a button on the sides with some LEDs. So I have to take my goggles off to see what my battery voltage is. Yada, yada, yada. No, just, whoop, there it is, 7.4 volts. Anyway, that's pretty freaking cool. Now, you can see here, I'm pressing the button one time to scroll through the channels. And if I hold the button down, 3 seconds, roughly, it gives two beeps and changes bands. And if I hold the button down for 5 seconds, it'll do an auto scan. There you go, there's auto scan. Now, I don't have a transmitter up, so it's not going to find anything, but there. So it's not quite as user-friendly as the modules with the OLED screen, but it's not bad. You can easily scroll through a single band just by pressing the button one time, switch bands, or auto scan if you're not sure what channel somebody is on. One place where this does fall short is if somebody says, hey, I'm on 5645, and you're like, well, what is that? What band is that? If you don't know what band it is, you're kind of out of luck. Whereas if you have a full-fledged module like a LaForge or a TrueD, you can actually just, it's much easier to navigate. But still, $350, right? What are you going to do? Now, right now, we're in the widescreen mode. This is a 16:9 screen, and the resolution is 858 by 480. So this is basically a 640 by 480 screen, but then stretched to 858 pixels wide to make it 16:9. If you do not have a 16:9 camera, and if you prefer, if you don't like the image stretch, you could press the mode button one time, and it'll go to 4:3. Now, I don't know if you can tell. I can see it here on the screen, but there's pillar boxing. You can see the pillar boxes on the side, and see if I can catch it. There you go. And so it is a little distracting having the slightly lighter black on the edges. I compared these head-to-head against the Attitude V4, and the screen size is roughly the same, but the Attitude V4 looks a little more seamless because it just has a 4:3 screen versus pillar boxing it. If I keep pressing that button, we'll go through the 3D modes, and we'll even go through HDMI input, which, of course, we're not going to see anything there. And then we're back in 16:9. Now you know the features of the goggles, and on paper, these goggles are really freaking impressive for their price. But what you don't know is what the sort of subjective experience of using them is like. And I really wanted to give these goggles a fair shake. So I took my diopter lenses. I have corrective lenses for my goggles. I did a video about them. Link in the upper right. I took my diopters out and I actually put them in the Aomways to sort of force me to use them as my primary goggles for a week or two. And I think they're not as good once you actually start using them as they look like on paper, which is not to say that they're not good and not to say that they're not worth the price. But to say that on paper, you look at them and you go, oh my God, these are incredible, right? They just knock your socks off. And when I actually started using them, I had to sort of begrudgingly nod and go, these are OSD and the goggles. Yeah, that's amazing. Why is more? Why, that's great. Why did we have to wait so long for that? And sort of tip my hat to them. But also, it was kind of a begrudging tip of the hat. So one of the things about them is that they were really uncomfortable on my face. Maybe I have a weird shaped face. But the curve of the faceplate put a lot of pressure here on my central facial area. And there wasn't curved enough to sort of take the weight here at the temples. And nothing I could do could really fix that. I have maybe thicker foam. I don't know. It just seems like it's not the right shape for my face. So they're not ultra comfortable to wear, especially for long periods of time. Another thing about them is that the screen with the 32-degree field of view is, well, it's small. Now, that's a little unfair because many of you are flying 32-degree field of view screens and you're doing just fine. I fully admit I've been flying Dominator HD2s for a long time. They have a 50-degree field of view, a massive screen, and I'm used to it. But I tried to fly a reasonably tight course with the Leggero 4-inch. Tried to really get into the trees and do some tight stuff that I thought would really show off the 4-inch quadcopter's, you know, what it was made for. And I had trouble seeing the gaps. I couldn't really see as much detail, both, I suppose, because the screen is lower resolution than the 800 by 600 screen in the Dominators, but also because it's a smaller screen, it was further away. I just couldn't see as well to hit small gaps. And this is like not, it's not like this is an area of the world that I don't know well. I know this area inside and out. I know all the gaps. I know where everything is. And I just didn't feel as confident flying on the smaller screen. Now that's a criticism of this goggle, but every goggle you buy in the $350 price point is going to have the same rough field of view. So it's just a criticism of the price point more than anything else, except for the Attitude SE, which had the 50-degree field of view for $350. God, the Attitude SE was such a good goggle. Well, okay, I know I had like 17 positive things to say about the goggles and only like 2 negative things. And one of those negative things, screen size, is really not fair because of the, you know, that's just the price range we're in. But I have to say that the way they felt on my face and the experience of flying with the smaller screens, some people out there are saying, oh, these are so good. These are my new primary goggles. Well, I wouldn't give up my HD2s or my HD3s for these. No way. And obviously, right? Those goggles are $100 to $200 more, especially if you put a diversity module in. So obviously they're preferable. That shouldn't really surprise you. If you're out there and you have a set of HD2s and you like these goggles better, I honestly don't know what you're talking about. But these goggles are pretty solid for the price, and they bring a ton of new features that I hope that it really kicks Fat Shark in the butt and we start seeing things like in-goggle OSD and so forth. Gosh, that would be great. And that's going to bring us to the end of this video. But there's one question that I haven't answered. And I should acknowledge it before I sign off. And the question is, which would I spend my $350 on if I was going to buy either the Aomway Commander or the Fat Shark Attitude V4? And the reason I've left off that question is that I don't want to bury that head-to-head comparison in a review of the Commander when maybe people who don't care about a review of the Commander just want to see the head-to-head. So I'm going to release a separate video with just the head-to-head. And for those of you who couldn't decide on your own based on the review of the two goggles, I'll tell you what I, well, yeah, let's be honest. I'm not going to just say, buy this one. But I'll compare them a little more directly to each other. That's going to do it for now, though. Thank you for watching. And as always, happy flying.